Hello, and welcome, highly valued subscribing members. Have you ever overlooked the significance of joint effusion in adult patients? Think about this: when you encounter even mild effusion in a case of subacute or chronic inguinal pain, do you simply attribute it to synovitis and move on? Have you considered the possibility of more serious underlying pathology, such as avascular necrosis or other clinically significant conditions? When scanning the hip joint with ultrasound in an adult patient who complains of persistent hip pain, do not dismiss the presence of joint effusion. This effusion in adult patients is not a benign or incidental finding. In contrast to pediatric cases, where transient effusion is often self-limiting, hip joint effusion in adults is abnormal and should be treated as a red flag. If the patient has had hip pain for over a month, and you identify a joint effusion, you should assume there is underlying pathology until proven otherwise. It is not the time to apply a wait-and-see approach. Chronic joint effusion in the adult hip is almost never physiologic and warrants immediate further workup. Please stay tuned, and I will get back to you soon. Join our Masterclass membership today and unlock a treasure trove of knowledge. Benefit from updated weekly videos, including inspiring lectures, clinical case discussions, and image interpretation insights. Elevate your skills and connect with like-minded doctors. Subscribe now for a brighter professional future. The clinical data and experience are clear. Over 80 to 90% of adults with persistent joint effusion and chronic hip pain have a definitive pathologic diagnosis, many of which require targeted intervention. It includes: first, degenerative pathology, osteoarthritis, femoroacetabular impingement, labral tears. Second, infection, including chronic septic arthritis or tuberculosis. Third, inflammatory disease, such as rheumatoid arthritis or axial spondyloarthritis. Fourth, avascular necrosis of the femoral head. Fifth, neoplastic conditions, like pigmented villonodular synovitis or even synovial sarcoma. Sixth, crystal arthropathy, less common in the hip, but still possible. These are not minor conditions. They are clinically significant, often progressive, and in some cases irreversible if not diagnosed in time. Your ultrasound findings may be the first clue, and potentially the only chance to catch these diseases early. Therefore, if you find joint effusion in the hip of an adult with chronic pain, your next step should be clear. Recommend MRI for further evaluation. Do not reassure the patient based on ultrasound alone. Do not assume this is reactive. We must hold ourselves to a higher diagnostic standard. Hip joint effusion in an adult signals underlying pathology. Don't dismiss it, work it up. I will present an extreme case of hip joint pain. The patient is a 28-year-old male foreign worker residing in South Korea for the past 3 years and has been employed in a mushroom spawn cultivation facility. He presents with a 2-year history of chronic right inguinal and gluteal pain, which intermittently radiates down the posterior thigh and, during severe episodes, extends to the calf. We focused on the fact of the long history of inguinal pain. The pain is consistently aggravated by specific movements and postures, including sitting cross-legged on the floor, taking wide steps, and transitioning from floor sitting to standing. He describes the average pain intensity as 7 out of 10 on the visual analog scale. Approximately 1 month ago, he received 2 sessions of local injections at a government-run medical facility, which resulted in only partial or temporary relief of symptoms. I started with an ultrasound scan of the right hip joint. Using a convex probe, I performed a longitudinal scan along the axis of the femoral neck and visualized the femoral head, femoral neck, and synovial recess. I identified joint effusion in the anteroinferior recess of the hip joint. Switching to a linear probe, I could visualize the joint effusion more clearly and noted cortical irregularity along the anterior aspect of the femoral neck. There is a synovial outpouching in the upper lateral aspect of the hip joint. I then moved to the upper lateral aspect of the joint, beneath the gluteus medius, using the convex probe. No specific pathology was observed on the joint capsule's superficial surface. As I continued to scan over the posterior capsule, the posterior transverse view revealed fluid outpouching into the posterior synovial recess, indicating the posterior extension of the joint effusion. In this transverse view, the ilioischial bone appears on the screen's left side, and the greater trochanter's posterior aspect is on the right. The low echoic transverse structure located deep to this is the quadratus femoris muscle. On plain X-ray, I noted ill-defined sclerosis involving the femoral neck, intertrochanteric region, and greater trochanter, primarily affecting the medullary cavity. If you cannot recognize the radiographic changes in the right femur, I recommend reviewing the tutorial on interpreting plain radiographs. You can tap on best way to interpret simple radiography and go through it again for a clearer understanding. Let's move on to the MRI findings. I will first demonstrate the axial and coronal T2 fat-saturated images. Axial T2 weighted MRI confirms a diffuse marrow-replacing lesion, represented by a high signal intensity soft tissue mass extending from the uppermost portion of the femoral neck, most of the femoral neck, into trochanteric region, and proximal femoral shaft. There is also joint effusion and transperiosteal infiltration of soft tissue extending through the periosteum into the adjacent soft tissues at the anteroinferior aspect of the femoral neck and proximal trochanteric area. Symmetric, wing-like soft tissue mass is noted anterior to the bone surface. The medial aspect of the lesser trochanter bone marrow, with clear evidence of transperiosteal tumor spreading into the adjacent soft tissue. The tumor measures 119 mm in longitudinal length and 6.1 mm in transverse width. Oblique T1 weighted imaging along the femoral neck axis demonstrates diffuse low signal intensity infiltration within the bone marrow cavity, measuring approximately 114 mm in longitudinal diameter. There is also joint effusion in the inferior recess and evidence of cortical irregularity. Coronal 3D imaging shows that the epiphysis remains uninvolved even with extensive marrow involvement in the femoral neck, intertrochanteric region, and proximal femoral shaft. Interestingly, although the patient is 28 years old, the plain radiograph shows an unfused growth plate at the femoral head. In young adults with open physis, the growth plate acts as a partial barrier to tumor spread, which may explain the lack of epiphyseal invasion in this case. This image demonstrates the transperiosteal spread of the tumor, with penetration into the adjacent soft tissue well. On post-contrast sequences, diffuse homogeneous enhancement within the intramedullary space, along with enhancing extraperiosteal soft tissue extending around the neck and lesser trochanteric region. The post-contrast MRI sequences correlate well with the ultrasound findings, confirming fluid accumulation in the posterior hip recess and demonstrating extraperiosteal tumor extension along the anterior and medial aspects of the femoral neck and intertrochanteric region. This case is not intended to train you in detailed MRI interpretation, but rather to raise awareness of the clinical significance of joint effusion in chronic hip pain, and to emphasize the importance of carefully evaluating simple radiographs for subtle but critical findings. Thank you for watching. It has been my honor to be with you. As an esteemed subscribing member, your support greatly motivates my journey of practical pain management on YouTube. I look forward to seeing you in the upcoming videos.